So we have formed a quorum. Members, this is already the scheduled time and we have formed a quorum. Welcome to the Zoom meeting of the panel on development. Members, please note, when you speak, you have to turn on the Zoom function and show your face, and your microphone will only be unmuted under my instruction. And if members have any papers or such as motion to submit, please send to the email of the panel. I'm sure you've all got the email address. Item 1, confirmation of minutes of our last meeting. Is paper CB 1393/2021. That's the minutes of our meeting held on the 27th of October 2020. After the minutes have been sent to members, the Secretariat has not received any proposal for amendments so far. So members, can we agree that the minutes be confirmed? There is no objection, right? Okay. Then I take it that members agree to confirm the minutes. Minutes confirmed. Item 2, information papers issued since the last meeting. They are already listed on our agenda. Item 3 is the items for discussion for our next meeting. You've all got the list of outstanding items for discussion, CB447/2021(01), as well as (02), that is the list of follow-up actions. The next meeting scheduled for the 23rd of February, Tuesday, at 2:30 p.m. to 5. There are 3 proposals from the administration. A is proposed creation of a non-civil service position equivalent to director rank in the Development Bureau to coordinate and implement the measures under the Invigorating Island South Initiative. The second is proposal of work by the Sustainable Land Office and staffing proposals of SLO Planning Department and Railway Development Office of Highways Department for taking forward an implementation of development and conservation projects related to Lantau. C is extension of Siu Ho Wan waterworks and improvement of water supply to Sha Tin, Shangshui, and Fanling. Members, do you agree that these 3 items will be for discussion at the next meeting? If there is no objection, then I take it that members agree to the 3 items. All right, there is no objection. The meeting scheduled for the 23rd of February. The format of to be held, since the COVID-19 is still serious, we will tentatively schedule the 23rd of February meeting to be a Zoom one, subject to a change in the epidemic situation. So the Secretariat will inform members as soon as possible that on the 23rd of February, our meeting will be a Zoom meeting. Item 4, the Public Works Project Item Number 332CL, and that is Item 332CL, West County Reclamation Main Works Remainder Footbridge at the junction of Shamong Road and Yan Chao Street West in Sam Shui Po. Present for this meeting on Zoom to answer members' questions are Ms. Louisa Yan, PS from Development Bureau, Mr. Samson Lam, Acting Project Manager from Civil Engineering and Development Department, and Mr. Raymond Lee, Chief Engineer from the same department. I give the floor to the administration to introduce the project to us first. You have got a PowerPoint presentation, right? Thank you. Very briefly, I'd like to brief members on the background, and then I will defer to colleagues from CED to brief members on the details of the project. The footbridge is at the junction of Shamong Road and Yan Chao Street West in Sham Shui Po. We'd like to build a footbridge at the roundabout. If members may refer to enclosure 3 of the paper, there is a map there, and then the blue square is where the footbridge is going to be. We'd like to seek funding approval from PWSC and FC to build the footbridge. Along Sham Mong Road, members can see that in 2016, we had funding approval from Finance Committee to construct a footbridge system at the junction of Sham Mong Road and Tong Kin Street West. And last year, we also got funding approval from the FC for another footbridge system at the junction of Sham Mong Road and Heng Wah Street West. So along Sham Mong Road, there will be 3 footbridges to complete the continuous grade separate pedestrian network. The purpose is to serve the population of about 72,000 from the 9 existing and future housing developments, and some 9,000 students from the 10 nearby primary and secondary schools. Apart from residents and primary and secondary school students living there, the footbridges will also help to boost the traffic capacity of the road. When we have a complete grade separated pedestrian network, then we can do away with the at grade crossings, and then that will boost the traffic capacity of the road. And that's the reason why we have proposed the remainder of the project to members. I can now defer to my colleague. Well, before presentation from the CED, I will invite members to raise their hands. Now, for those who have raised their hands, please put them down, and now you can raise your hands. All right, if you would like to speak, do raise your hands now. Mr. Frankie Yick, you have to press the virtual raise hand function rather than physically raise your hand. All right, please press the virtual raise hand function on Zoom. All right, I will now give the floor to the administration to do the PowerPoint presentation for us. Yes. All right, we can see the PowerPoint now. Please proceed. Thank you, Chair. I've got a few simple slides to brief you on the project. As said by the colleague, the purpose is to upgrade the remainder of 332CL to grade A, to category A. Now, the blue square is the junction of Sham Mong Road and Yan Chao Street West. There are a number of housing developments here. Counting from the left, Fu Cheng Estate, Wing Cheng Estate, Kalinan West and Nam Cheng Estate, the population is over 30,000 now. Many residents will have to use the crossings marked by the blue square to get to Nam Cheng Station, the open space, and also the park here. Since Sham Mong Road is a major distributor in the district, you can see the current traffic condition at 6 p.m. on a weekday. The red lines are traffic. The traffic volume is high. Sometimes there is tailback of traffic. with population intake of nearby residential developments, the traffic will only be busier, and the road capacity will be overburdened. And as for pedestrian crossings, pedestrians will have to manage 6 to 7 traffic lanes before they can cross a road. However, the signal time is limited. Now, for they have to first walk through the junction 1 and then to 2, and to wait for the next green phase, it will be some time. So this is our observation. Many pedestrians are anxious and they walk diagonally or jump the red phase. That would pose danger both to pedestrians and vehicles. To enhance safety of both vehicles and pedestrians, to enhance the traffic capacity, and to enhance connectivity, we propose to build the footbridge here. This slide shows you the location of the proposed footbridge and the relevant works. The blue square is the four-span covered footbridge system, and each span ranges from about 35 meters to 52 meters. And at all four corners, there will be lifts providing around-the-clock connectivity to link up the footbridge and also pedestrians' network in the vicinity.
To the west of the footbridge, it goes directly to a shopping center above the Nam Chong MTR station. So the pedestrians can go to and from that MTR station safely and conveniently. As for Fuchong Estate, Tong Chau Street Park, and Nam Chong Park, now there are two elevators that provide 24-hour access. And as marked by red, there are staircases, and as marked by orange, covered escalators to link up with the pedestrian walkways, and there are some also ancillary drainage works. Now, this slide shows a section, cross-section of the footbridge. Now, concerning the design, we have consulted the Advisory Committee on Bridges and Buildings. Now, this is a bird's-eye view of the completed footbridge complex. Now, this footbridge links up Shenmong Street and Tongkin Street West, and it will form a safe and comfortable pedestrian environment so that the residents can go to the MTR Namcheong Station public transport interchange and nearby leisure, cultural and social welfare facilities. Now, this footbridge enhances road safety. Now, it avoids at-grade pedestrian crossings, and it improves the access compared to traffic lights. And schools and residents all look forward to the commissioning of this footbridge. At money of the day prices, it's estimated that the system will cost $230 million. That includes cost for the structure, $140 million, and then there are the escalators, lifts, that's about $90 million. and there are other associated roadway works. So totally, that will be $330 million estimated. Now we hope that by the middle of this year, we can start the construction and to complete the works within 4 years. So we thank you for your viewing. Now, I remind members, if you have direct or indirect pecuniary interest on this item, please follow rules of procedure 83A and disclose your interest before you speak. And please note ROP 84, where there is direct, where there is pecuniary interest, there are certain regulations on voting. Now, Vincent Chang, Alice Mack, Holden Chow, Yik Chi Ming have indicated the wish to speak. This item will take us to about 10 past 3. Members will speak first, 4 minutes first each. Vincent Chang. Thank you. Now, I know that there is item on the heritage site at the Bishop Hill. Now, I may not have time to speak on that. In principle, I agree with the footbridge project at Shenmong Road. There is a need for this facility. In the past 2 years, there have been new facilities completed on both sides, housing estates and housing developments. So there is heavy traffic load. So I hope that this will relieve the traffic pressure and enhance safety for pedestrians. Now, with this footbridge complex, now some pavements will be removed or replaced. So speed, the speed of vehicles will be increased, and yet some people will continue to use the crossing, so the traffic lights need to be improved. Now, this connects to Yan Chow Street, which is an old district near the police station. So we hope that there will be more facilities so that more people will use the footbridge. Now, on the old area, Hoi Lai Estate, the residents there hope that there can be a footbridge that connects directly to Hoi Lai Estate, so they wouldn't have to brave the weather. Before members respond to your question, now Mr. Chang talked about the conservation issue at Bishop Hill in Hampshire Pole. Now, on the 12th of January, we provided a written response, CB1433, document 01. And as in the past, in the second quarter, the administration will report to this council the progress on heritage projects, and you can follow up that on that. That's item 7. On the list of items for discussion. Now, response from the administration, please. Now, on the first 2 points, on vehicle speed, we will follow up with Transport Department. Now, on the Hoi Lai Street footbridge, I will ask the CEDD to supplement. Now, on the linkage with Hoi Lai Street, Hoi Lai Estate. Now, I believe that's the one at the Hinghua Street. There is a pedestrian crossing system under construction. A connection point is near Hoi Lai Estate. We are now actively exploring whether outside of that point, connecting with the at-grade pedestrian walkway, there could be additional covered passageway that goes into Hoi Lai Estate. Now, we need time for detailed design for that. So we will follow up on that. We thank the departments. I hope that they can come up with a viable solution so that there can be overall enhancement at Sham Mong Road. Now, on vehicle speed, do you have more information? Will there be arrangements on the traffic lights? Traffic management, yes. We thank Mr. Cheng for his reminder. What Mr. Cheng pointed out is a public concern. Now, after building the footbridge complexes, we will take a look at the pedestrian lights. We hope to do away with the green lights, and the time taken up for green lights, for pedestrian green lights, would be used for easier and faster vehicle traveling. Now, of course, we monitor the vehicle speed. Now, usually in urban areas, the limit is 50 kilometers per hour. Now, at Sham Mong Road, we will closely monitor the situation. Right now, one of the footbridge complexes is at Tongkin Street and Sham Mong Road Junction. That is already completed. Now, overall, the operation has been smooth. We will be in contact with the Transport Department specialist to see whether there should be additional measures to control the traffic speed, the speed of vehicles here. Alice Mack, 4 minutes. Alice Mack. Chairman, we see that some pedestrian footbridge complexes being introduced. We support those. Now, in many projects, the government has a good concept to build a good footbridge complex. But whether the residents will use it, that's another issue. There are many beautiful footbridges built, and yet the pedestrians still cross the road illegally at grade. So, and then we later we will ask, someone will ask the administration to put back some traffic lights. So we have the infrastructure, but is this infrastructure convenient for the residents, or would they rather dash across the junction for the sake of convenience and speed? We thank Ms. Max for her point. Now, we closely monitor the situations. Now, for instance, the footbridge system at Hinghua Road, Sham Mong Road, and Tongkin Street, Sham Mong Road, and the current one, Yanchao Street complex. Now, we hope that all of these will make things convenient for the public. There are staircases, we have escalators, we have two lifts. Given the geographical limitations, we try to enhance these facilities so that they have the incentive to use the footbridge. Now, for at-grade crossing facilities, if we keep them, then the effectiveness of the footbridge works would be reduced. Now, at Tongkin Street pedestrian footbridge complex, we have already completed that, and the at-grade crossing facility has been removed. This makes vehicle traffic more smooth, and the pedestrians will not have to cross the street by walking across. Now, after the Tongjiang footbridge street complex has been completed, we did a counting exercise. Now, in enclosure 2, we the photos showing that the usage rate is quite high. Now, at 7 something in the morning, at the peak hour, there are 18 persons use that facility. Now, the other counts all come close to 1,000. So, totally 3 to 4,000 persons make use of the facility. So, this is within our estimation and target. So in future, where the location permits, we will try to provide the most convenience. Next, Holden Chow, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. You hear me clearly, yes. I'd like to ask, now, looking at this arrangement, the Shenmong Road, this is now the third footbridge system on that road. Now, if we look at enclosure 3 to the document, now, for that road, there are 3 similar junctions, all with pedestrian footbridge complexes for the previous 2. Now, as I recall, in LegCo, I asked some questions on them. So, of course, building the footbridge is for the sake of convenience and safety for residents. I'm concerned that after the footbridge is built, the at-grade crossing facilities will be removed. And the administration explained that this is for smoother vehicular traffic beneath the footbridge. Now, for this footbridge complex, it's over a crossing. So you have a good idea of the how the traffic moves. So if you remove the foot traffic lights, will it really make traffic more smooth? Now you have arrangements for vehicles to start and stop. Now, if you, because they have to start and stop there anyway. Now, there are 3 footbridge complexes, and for this long stretch of road, there is no, there will be no pedestrian crossing at all. So, if the residents really want to cross in the way they were used to, can they do so? Now, of course, some crossings have been removed, will be removed. Now, but it's a long stretch of road. 3 junctions, will they all lose their pedestrian crossings? So, will that reduce the convenience of the residents?
Thank you. Mr. Lam? Thank you, Mr. Chow, for your question. Now, Let me give you some statistics involving this junction. In distributing or allocating traffic signals, take Yam Chow Street and Shamong Street as example. One cycle takes 130 seconds. 30 seconds will involve a stopping of traffic on all sides. And then for the remaining 100 seconds, they are roughly equally distributed among the four crossings. That is 25 seconds each. With this bridge constructed and pedestrian at grade crossings removed, the 30 seconds can then be allocated to vehicular traffic. That means the capacity or can be boosted by 30%. And this is really quite a big progress. We do understand that in allocating the traffic signal phases, we have other considerations. For instance, shortening the cycles. That means that you have to wait not so long in at a red phase, and then again that can improve traffic. Mr. Chow asked whether we will maintain some at-grade crossings. We have considered this possibility. In fact, from Sham Mong Road to exit A of Nam Chong Station, there is a simple perpendicular crossing. And we may be able to keep this at grade crossing because it is relatively simple and there is no need for pedestrians to wait for traffic phases on four roads. So this can still be maintained. We are closely monitoring the situation and also the progress of the system. Our plan now is still to keep that at grade crossing. And for users that really need a grade crossing, there is still an option there. Mr. Frankie Yick, 4 minutes. Yes, Mr. Frankie Yick. Thank you, Chair. First, I'd like to indicate my support for the project because I used this section a number of times last year, and indeed, the pedestrian traffic was quite busy, as suggested by the administration, and therefore I support the construction of this footbridge. The road is very wide and is not very safe for pedestrians to cross at grade. Since we have spent so much money on other footbridges and this will have lifts and escalators, then I really think that we should minimize the number of at grade crossings. That is from the perspective of traffic and transport. And in fact, it's quite dangerous for people to cross at grade. So the fewer at grade crossings, the better. But $330 million seems to be a bit pricey. Can you please explain why this footbridge system is going to be that expensive? Mr. Lam, thank you, Mr. Yick, for your questions. The project will cost about $300 million. We have taken reference from another project of pedestrian footbridge system at Henghua Street West done last year, or the tender price of the project. So we have taken into account the latest tender prices. But then, for the construction of the footbridge, it's going to cost about $200 million. We have to bear in mind that there are constraints here. For instance, near Nam Chong Estate, there are now noise barriers. They are rather tall. We have to remove some of them and then install temporary noise barriers. And then we will build permanent ones after the project is complete. That would cost us some money. And then we want to provide as much convenience to the public as possible. So we would like to have two sets of lifts and also two-way escalators at all landing points, in addition to staircases. All these accounted towards the project cost. Among the $330 million, there is a contingency of about 10% as usual. All in all, we have taken reference from our latest tender prices returned in July last year in coming up with this cost. All right, this is near Nam Cheng Station, and the MTR line is just underneath. Will this cost some extra costs to the project? Well, Nam Cheng Station is to the west. In fact, along Sham Mong Road, we have the alignment of the XRL. So we have to be careful. We have reserved some money for clear site confirmation. And then a confirmation before we build the groundworks, and we have included that in our project cost. Mr. Chen and Pan will be the last to speak because we still have two more items on the agenda. The last one in particular is about the environmental friendly linkage system in Kowloon East, subject close to the heart of many. So I will end the discussion of this item after Mr. Chen Han Pan. Thank you. Am I coming through? Yes, very clearly. Thank you, Chair. I support footbridges like this because in Chunwan, we mainly use pedestrian footbridges for pedestrian traffic. But for the footbridge proposed here, there will be new development projects. And can the footbridge linked up with these new developments so that future residents can just rely on the footbridge for traveling from home and to other parts of the area. And in other districts, we have seen poor environmental hygiene of such footbridges in other districts. The lifts are also rather dirty. So can you improve the cleanliness and also maintenance of such lifts and escalators and footbridges after completion? Administration, thank you. Indeed, the design has already taken into account connection to topside development on Nam Cheng Station. This will facilitate residents going to the shopping center there or going to the MTR station. It will provide a convenient covered walkway for residents. When it comes to the environmental hygiene of lifts and footbridges, usually we have a certain maintenance period upon completion. Take the footbridge for Tongkang Street West as an example. We have our contractor to carry out regular cleaning for a certain period of time. Of course, in future, the footbridge will be handed over to relevant departments for management and maintenance, and we will make a note to these departments to follow up the environmental hygiene issues of footbridges. So we thank Mr. Chen for his reminder. Thank you. Well, we talk about cleanliness. Of course, you have a contractor to do it during the warranty period. But after the footbridge is handed over to respective departments, the cleanliness is rather undesirable because there are contractors to clean our streets, but these footbridges are much dirtier. I hope that the departments can ensure cleanliness of footbridges. If you are incapable of keeping them clean, please ask other departments to do it for you so that members of the public would not complain about the poor environmental hygiene of footbridges. Please relay to the relevant departments. I'm sure the government has heard it. Given the such good facilities, they should be properly maintained and cleaned so that residents will be satisfied. All right, now, from what I've heard from members, they are all supportive of the project. I think you won't object to our submitting or recommending this to the PWSC, all right? I don't see any objection. So we agree that the paper be handed to the PWSC for its consideration. We move on to the next item, and that is PWP. Item number 056WS, improvements of saltwater supply to Chun Wan and Kwai Chung. We have now until 3:45 to discuss this item. All right. From the administration, we have Mr. Thomas Chang, PAS. From Development Bureau, Mr. Irene Pang, Assistant Director from Water Supplies Department, and Mr. Ho Kai Ho, Chief Engineer from the same department. I'll give the floor to the administration for an introduction. All right, members want to raise hands, so please raise your virtual hands if you would like to ask questions. I can only see one hand, and that is from Mr. Michael Tian. If there are members who would like to ask questions, do raise the virtual hand now.
So the administration, please. Mr. Thomas Chen, you can speak now. We can now start to see the slides. Today, we'd like to brief you on a works project, 056WS, improvement of salt water supply to Chun Wan and Kwai Chung. Now, right now, Chun Wan and Kwai Chung, their salt water supply are mainly provided by two pump sets, the blue and red parts. The blue part is from Chun Wan seawater pumping plant, whereas the red part is from Kwai Chung Hospital. They have a salt water supplying system. Now, for the Kwai Chung Hospital salt water supply system, it's mainly for the cooling in the hospital. So we make use of that resource to provide saltwater flushing for the hospital and nearby neighborhoods. Now, with the redevelopment plans for the Kwai Chung Hospital, this saltwater supply system will no longer be used. So we will replace it. So we will supply the red area from the Chin Wan seawater pumping plant. Now, the Chin Wan seawater pumping plant will also cater to the new housing developments of Chin Wan and Kwai Chung. The red parts are the future new housing projects. They include public and private housing. Now, right now, the Chin Wan seawater pumping station, they serve about 510,000 population. With the new housing developments by 2032, there will be 720,000, whereas the Chin Wan SWPS, its daily production is 101,000 cubic meters, and this has to be raised to 140,000 cubic meters per year. And this will no longer be able to cater to need by 2025. Now, this shows the scope of the works. Now, mainly at the Chin Wan pumping station, right now there are four pumps there. We need to have two more to upgrade to 141,000 cubic meters per day. And right now they are using a electrical chlorination system to provide what's commonly called the bleach for the sterilizing. And we will replace that by a sodium hypochlorite solution dosing system. This will be used for cleansing instead. And then we have to lay a 3.3 kilometer mains of 600 millimeters in diameter to extend the supply area to Liking and northwestern Lai Chi Kok. The orange line will go through Kwai Fook Road, Kwai Ching Road, the container terminal south road to go to the new area. At money of the toll prices, it will cost 346 million dollars. Now, this goes on private land, so there is no land resumption required. It goes on public land. It will also have... Now, we have completed a preliminary environmental assessment. We have ascertained that there will be no long-term environmental impact. And we have also completed a traffic impact assessment. And during the construction period, we will apply some traffic management measures in order to reduce any deleterious impact. And we have obtained the support of the Advisory Committee, Traffic Environmental Advisory Committee of the Chin Wan Kwai Chung area. And if we get funding from Finance Committee in March, we will start the works in the third quarter of this year. And then we will need about 48 months to complete the whole project. And at the Finance Committee, after we receive the funding, we will then enter into contracts for the works. Now, before members ask questions, I remind you, now this involves funding. If you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest regarding this project, in accordance with Rule of Procedure 83A, before you speak, please disclose the nature of the interest. And please note RLP 84, where there is direct pecuniary interest, there are certain regulations on voting. If you wish to speak, please raise your virtual hand. Michael Chan, 4 minutes each, first. Thank you. This Tsinghua and Kaichung salt water supply system improvement. Now, there are two figures. Now, firstly, from Tsinghua seawater pumping station, there will be two new pump sets, and there will be an upgrading of the chlorination system. And then there's a 3.3 kilometer main, and that will cost $330 million. Now, so there's no breakdown. Please tell me, how does this break down to make up the $330 million? We thank the member for his question. This, for laying off the mains, that's $270 million. The remainder, so the mains are $270 million. And now paragraph 6, that you says that there will be new buildings in Tsinghua Kaichung. The Tsinghua seawater pumping station will not be able to supply their needs. So you will be doing the upgrading. So you have to spend the $80 million. But that's not where the main cost lies. The mains cost $270 million. Do you really have to pay for the $270 million? Right now you have Tsinghua District, Kaichung District. They have two systems in themselves. So you want now the Kaichung system, you want the Tsinghua system to be connected to Liking Kaichung, and you want to solve the problem in one go. Now, the connection will cost $270 million just to link up the two systems and integrate them as one. Now, of course, you can keep the two systems. Then for the old system, the MSD will not take care of it, so you can get it back. So for me to support your project, if you keep the two existing systems, you either upgrade the MSD system or you maintain the saltwater pumping system. That will certainly cost less than $270 million. Now, we have considered that issue as well. For the Kaichung Hospital, the saltwater pumping plant, now in 1981 it was completed. It has been in use for over 40 years. Now the previous design back then is not up to par by current standards. For instance, if you redevelop it, how much would it cost? Now, please, let the administration finish first. For instance, if we are going to reuse the pumping station for long term, we have to upgrade it to current standards. Right now, the pump motors are installed underground to prevent impact of flooding in the future affecting the motors. And we have to move the motors to above ground. I'm asking about the cost. Mr. Chen, please let Mr. Chen reply first. Because you interrupt him, please be patient. There will be time for you to ask. I can be flexible. Because of the design issue for upgrading, the entire pumping station has to be redeveloped to meet current standards. Now, we expect that will cost $140 million. But in the course of redevelopment, the pumping station cannot function. Now at Lai King and Lai Chi Kok, northwestern part of Lai Chi Kok, we will then have to supply, we will provide, have to a substitute water supply system. So the most direct way is to provide the supply from Chin Wan seawater pumping station. So that involves laying a pipe to provide the water to this area. So basically that's the same as our current proposal. So we provide the temporary substitute source, then it already meets the project needs of the current project. So what I'm talking about is $130 million less, but in the meantime, there's no saltwater supply. You have to provide provisional mains. So to obviate that, you will do away with the Kwai Chung pumping station, correct? For redevelopment, that will take about 3 years. So we need a substitute water source. Thank you for explanation. So I gain an understanding, as did Mr. Tian. So the government did consider the possibility. Next, Houdin Chow. 4 minutes. Thank you, I'm ready. I'd like to confirm. Now, it seems that administration has made this point. Now, in the redevelopment of Kwai Chung Hospital, there will be no saltwater supply. And now you build, you lay the new mains. This will cover not just the needs of Kwai Chung Hospital during redevelopment. Besides, after Kwai Chung Hospital redevelopment has been completed, you will make use of these new mains. In the future, after development, redevelopment of Kwai Chung Hospital, you don't need that saltwater supply system. Is that right? Mr. Chen, Mr. Chow's explanation, understanding is correct. The Chin Wan seawater pumping station system has been extended to Kwai Chung Hospital and nearby neighborhoods that will meet long-term needs. So, okay, I understand. So I was wondering whether there will be a new saltwater supply system required. So I know now there would be no need for that.
All right, any other members who would like to ask questions? I couldn't see any hand. So please return to our gallery view. Do members support that a paper be submitted to PWSC? Now, this is really a livelihood project, supply of salt water, right? I do not see any objection or query from members. So we support the administration to submit the paper to PWSC. Thank you. Now we move on to the next item. That is item 6 on our agenda. Findings and recommendations of detailed feasibility study for a mental friendly linkage system EFLS for Kowloon East. For the paper, for discussion, please refer to the agenda. Now, we have quite a long list of government officials attending this part of our discussion. Mr. Michael Wong, Secretary for Development. Mr. Vincent Mack, Deputy Secretary from Development Bureau. Mr. Victor Chen, PAS. Mr. Ken Kwok Chang, Deputy Head of Energizing Kowloon East Office. Dr. Raymond So, Undersecretary for Transport and Housing, Mr. Ricky Lau, Director of Civil Engineering and Department and Development, Mr. Michael Leung, Project Manager from CENDD, Mr. Tim Lam, Acting Senior Engineer from CENDD, Mr. Gary Wong, Chief Traffic Engineer from Transport Department, and also Ms. Winnie Wong, Principal Transport Officer, also from Transport Department. Administration, please give us a brief introduction of the paper. I can see hands from members. Yes, you may raise hands now. Dr. Martin Liu, Mr. Lau Kwok Fan, Mr. Frankie, and Ms. Alice Mack. Any others? Any other members who would like to ask questions, you may raise your hands now. Administration, yes. Mr. Michael Wong, Secretary for Development, have a go first. Yes, very briefly from me. This is Michael Wong. The Development Bureau, the Transport and Housing Bureau, CNDD, would like to report to the panel the findings and recommendations of the detailed feasibility study. We started the study in 2014, and then we briefed members on the finding of the study in 2017 and commenced the second stage of the DFS in the second half of 2017. Now, in the course of the study, CEDD encountered more than expected complicated challenges, therefore requiring more time to review and explore feasible solutions, including studying on options other than the elevated mode. Besides the long-term financial viability and cost-effectiveness of EFLS, also one of the important considerations of the DFS detailed feasibility study. At present, the government has substantially completed the DFS on the proposed EFLS. Now, on the basis of the current facilities and also transport service network, they are proposing a multimodal EFLS. I now give the floor to my colleague to give you a detailed briefing. Mr. Michael Leung, CNDD. Thank you. I'd like to brief you on the findings and recommendations of the DFS for EFLS. As said by the Secretary for Development, in our DFS, we encountered lots of technical complications and challenges, particularly for those parts in developed areas. So, technically, will be constrained by the very dense development in the city for an elevated system, and this is not really a financially viable and preferable option. And then, on the basis of the increasingly comprehensive road and railway infrastructure facilities, as well as the convenient public transport services provision area, the study recommends to implement a supplementary multimodal EFLS in Kowloon East, so as to meet the prevailing traveling of the people, connect with the neighborhood areas conveniently, and to help shape Kai Tak into an environmental-friendly area. The relevant departments are committed to providing convenient and appropriate public transport services to meet the demand of the department or of the development of the Kai Tak area. Line Phase 1 was commissioned in mid-February last year, and then the remaining line will be commissioned soon. And over 8% of the public can be served by the railway traffic there. And there are over 130 franchised bus routes and more than 30 GMB routes serving Kowloon East. Now, as for cross-district road networks, the government is taking forward Route 7 to directly link up West Kowloon and Chung Kwan O, providing traffic relief to the major east-west road corridors in Kowloon and Chun Kwan and Chang Kwan Oh. The target is to complete it in 2026, and then the other road network will be completed in 2022 to make it easier for people to travel to the cruise terminal. Now, we are proposing the following. Under the multimodal EFLS in Kowloon East, there will be enhanced connectivity and complementarity. The details are, number one, we will enhance public transport services in Kowloon East and deploy electric vehicles to run new bus or GMB routes in the area. The transport department has gradually enhanced public transport services in the area. In between 2019 and 2020, there will be four new franchise bus routes and GMB routes to link up the Kwantung area and also Kai Tak, and link up with Yau Tong, Diamond Hill. These new routes will avoid Kwantung Road to lessen the burden on this major road. It will cover the elevated route proposed and the patronage. It's very close to the projected capacity of the elevated structure of 216,000. There is 90A, 19B, and 22M already commissioned. For the remaining three new franchise routes, they can be commissioned in between 2023 to 2028. And we will consult the District Council on new proposals. The government will introduce green and smart transport initiatives. We plan to gradually introduce from this year onwards the deployment of electric buses or electric public light buses for the above-mentioned six additional routes. Besides, smart public transport interchanges will be provided at KTAA, KBAA, and Tourism Node site, with the provision of charging facilities to support the deployment of electric vehicles, offering better passenger waiting environment and add-on passenger facilities such as aircon waiting halls with seats, free Wi-Fi service, and interactive display panels. The government also proposes to develop a travelators network that link up the former runway of Kai Tak and the Kowloon Bay Area and Kwantung area. For Wai Yip Street, we propose to build a 1.3-kilometer long elevated walkway linking up Kowloon Bay and Kwantung action areas, providing a convenient pedestrian corridor. The proposed elevated walkway will be equipped with travelators to enhance walking comfort. At appropriate locations, there will also be rooftop garden along the elevated walkway. We also propose to build a 230-meter long elevated walkway at Shenyu Road to connect Kowloon Bay AA and the future footbridges across Wai Yip Street near Siu Yip Street and further to MTR Kowloon Bay Station. Again, there will be travelators. Now for the Kwantung Typhoon Shelter, we propose to build a 600-meter long pedestrian cum cyclist bridge with travelators to directly link up the Typhoon Shelter and also the former Kai Tak runway on its both sides. It will also facilitate pedestrians to move between the former runway area and the MTR Outer Cox Station via Lai Yip Street. The bridge will be within the Victoria Harbour, and the bridge proposal is subject to control of the protection of the Harbour Ordinance, and we plan to commence a technical study this year so as to gather relevant, cogent, and convincing materials to consult the public. And we are going to provide a 30-kilometer-long greenway network in KDT, which will link up various points, including Kai Tak Station Square, Kai Tak Sports Park, Kai Tak River, and the promenades along both sides of KTTS. Unlike conventional separated footway and cycle path, the greenway mainly adopts a shared use concept for cyclists and pedestrians to allow better utilization of the open spaces and our frontline area. And we are going to commission a study on the design and implementation of a greenway. And the first phase of about 7.5 kilometers long is targeted to be completed by 2023, with the remaining phase of about 5.5 kilometers long beyond 2025. Fourthly, we propose to construct an 120-meter-long elevated landscape deck to connect the MTR Kuntong Station and also the URA project, and also to relieve the congestion of the Kuntong MTR Station at peak traveling time. And then we've already granted operating license in early 2020 for launching the water taxi service, and the operator is preparing for the water taxi service plying Central, West Kowloon, Tsim Sha Tsui East, Hong Kong and Kai Tak, and will render technical support to set up the water taxi service point at the existing landing steps of the Kai Tak Runway Park Pier to offer more choices for passengers. In conclusion, the multimodal EFLS will offer more choices for commuters, and they can serve complementarily. And early delivery of various green linkage initiatives to launch services progressively and more pursuable than single elevated mode of EFLS.
On the timeline, the single mode, elevated mode, that will take 5 years to choose the operator and design, and 5 years for construction, totally 10 years. Whereas the multimodal mode, it can be completed and commissioned between now and 2028. Some of the bus services are already in operation, and three routes will be in operation between 2023 and 2028. And the water taxi will also come into operation later this year, depending on the pandemic. Now, on the greenway, that can be commissioned in 2023, latest by 2025. The other facilities will be commissioned between 2025 and 2028. Now, this timetable is rather aggressive. Now, through the multimodal linkage system and the environmental friendly facilities, we will link up Kai Tak, Kuntong, Outau Kok, the traffic interchange, and the MTR station. So there will be less use of bicycles, and it will help the traffic, and it will improve the environment for the Kowloon East becoming a secondary business center. And we will try to complete the procedures as quickly as possible to implement the project. And now, members' question time. Martin Liao, Lau Kuo Fan, Yik Chi Ming, Alice Mack, Or Chong Heng Sheng. Michael Tian raised his virtual hand, and then he lowered it. If any other member wishes to speak, please use our virtual hand raising system. If you cannot make use of that system, the secretariat has a phone number that has been supplied to you, and you can contact the secretariat. 4 minutes each, including question and answer. Martin Liao first. Chairman, Now, the Energizing Kowloon East project is to try to make Kai Tak a second central business district. Now, whether Kai Tak can be energized, it depends on the transport planning. Earlier, it was expected that the Kai Tak development area population by 2030, that will be 134 million. It was a working population of almost 120,000. Now, this figure is not raised this time. Is this multimodal project sufficiently forward-looking, taking into account the population growth? Now, if you increase the traffic routes and you increase the pedestrian network, if that solves the problem, so why did the government spend over 10 years on the monorail feasibility? Now, you are now increasing the number of electrical minibuses and electrical buses, but buses take roads to travel on. Now, the Kowloon East traffic load is already a serious problem. Can it sustain the additional load? This needs more study, which will take time. And the monorail system, when it was planned, what will replace the capacity of that system? So I have some reservations about the proposal. I hope an explanation can be provided. Question about the water taxi. The administration expected that the service will commence at the end of last year. That was the original plan. Are we now awaiting the arrival of tourists to come back to Hong Kong? Now, will the water taxi divert the passengers from the cruise terminal, the runway park? How many area will that be accommodated? We thank Mr. Liao for the questions. Now, on traffic capacity, now when back then, when we considered the elevated mode, now, we expected about 266,000 passengers per day. Now we have the railroad plus public buses, including buses that are environmentally friendly. Our experts can expect that can serve 266,000 passengers per day as originally planned. A water taxi? Now, the operator going ahead with the provision of the service. Now, given the economic development and the development of tourism, we expect that the short-term services, short-run, we expect that the service for short distances can be started early this year. Now, if you really just increase the number of vehicles, but if there are no new roads, how will that solve the problem? And also, it took 5 years to choose an operator. Why did it take that long? On roads, now within the area, there are various improvements in the area. Right now, under this multi-modal development, we have different travelator systems. So in Kwun Tong area, almost 80% of the traffic. Now, mostly they are for traveling to the MTR station that within 800 meters or it takes a 5 minutes walk. So would be Ms. Wong on Mr. Wong of the Transport Department. Now on Kwun Tong area, now the bottleneck area is Kwun Tong Road and the Hoi Yun Road roundabout. Now the Transport Department and other departments have been follow up on the problem. At Kwun Tong Road, Hoi Yun Road roundabout, we will have a special left turn carriageway to divert traffic so that it doesn't have to go through the roundabout and it can turn at Hip Wall Road. Now, at Hong Ning Road southbound, it will connect to Kwun Tong Road westbound. So it will divert the traffic so the cars will not be stuck at that roundabout. Now, as for the road network nearby, we have a series of projects ongoing or being planned to try to improve the accessibility in the area. Now, for the transport in Kowloon East, looking at now there was there will be a route six by 2026 that will alleviate the east-west transport flow in Kowloon East. Next, Lau Kok Fun. Now looking at the environmentally friendly linkage system, now for residents in Kowloon East, they are very disappointed that the government has decided to cancel the EFLS after so many years of study. Now some of the residents moved into the area because they expected there will be the monorail. Now, this project started in 2014 and there have been many years of study now. But you should have understood the problem earlier on. Why is it that you only now conclude that the monorail system doesn't work? Why the delay in your disclosure? Now, the elevated mode is supposed to increase the traffic capacity. Now, if you use the buses, you increase the environmentally friendly element, but it doesn't really resolve the traffic issue. So the monorail system, can you reduce the length for the technically difficult parts? Then you don't use the monorail, you can use travelators and so on. And you just have the travelator at Kai Tak. Now actually the at grade surface is not wide, so for the travelators maybe after a few years, you will conclude that it's infeasible, as in the case of the monorail, and then it will come to naught. We understand the disappointed mentioned by Mr. Lau. We understand that it took a long time studying the project, the monorail project, but we try to be practical. When we see great difficulties or huge costs, then we have to tell the public. And I'd like to share with the member that we are not disclosing this very late. Now, in March 2019, well, Mr. Oh Cheong Sing asked this question, and in my answer, I said that we have been we have come across difficult challenges, and in the policy we addressed last year, we already disclosed that we will adopt a multimodal system. Now, the challenge of the elevated system is how do you connect, say, from Hoi Yun Road back to the MTR station. Now in the Kai Tak New Development Area, it has ample traffic, transport facilities, so there's really no need there for a monorail at that part of the new development area. Now, looking at the situation at Wai Yip Street, it's not very desirable. Maybe you will tell us current projects will be infeasible. Now, at Kai Yip Street, the 1.3 kilometer footbridge plus the travelator lift system, we think that we are confident that it's it can be done. And then we will do more complete study, we will gazette our proposals, and then we'll come to let's go for funding. And then by 2027, we expect the footbridge to be completed. And the other issues also help the accessibility, for instance, the landscape deck. That should be completed in 2025. It's much shorter. Next, Ye Chi Meng, 4 minutes. The Secretary, now, listening to your colleagues just now, sorry, we can't hear Mr. Yik. Sorry, I will start again. Now, the introduction was quite dazzling. I'm not very clear about the routes. Now, in the future, from the runway area where there are a lot of residential developments, if people go out to the rest of the territory, how many routes are there? Now, at Wan Chiu Road, there's a lot of congestion. Will you have another road for exit? And in your diagram, now there's the greenway for pedestrians and the cyclists. Now, this is very ideal. Now, but in practice, there will be a lot of quarrels. So how wide is this greenway? Will there be a dividing line marked on the surface of the greenway? Otherwise, there will be a lot of quarrels. Now, you expect the people to take their bicycles there, or there will be bicycles for rent there for people to go to their destinations? And also, I'm concerned about the arrangements for the cruise terminal. Now, you mainly consider the residents who work and live there. Now, for the cruise terminal, usually the passengers arrive in the morning at 7 a.m. and between 7 and 9, there would be about 4,000 passengers disembarking. And that's the peak hour. The taxis don't go there. Now, and at Wan Chiu Road, there will be a long queue, so the taxis don't want to go there. So how do you provide the facilities for passengers arriving by cruise terminal? And the water taxis are too limited in capacity, and the surface is too infrequent and the cost is too high, so people cannot use the cruise passengers cannot use the water taxis to go to other places.
The traffic serving the cruise terminal, I will invite the transport department to respond. Regarding public transport services for the cruise terminal, the transport department has closely monitored the demand from passengers. Now, when a cruise calls, they will liaise with the nearby shopping malls, and then there will be free shuttle buses taking passengers to places like Tsim Sha Tsui. And then the cruise terminal will also issue the arrival times of ships to taxi associations so that they be made aware of the traffic demand from passengers. Regarding the road network for the cruise terminal, now in our consultation paper, or rather in the information paper enclosure 2, we mentioned D3 Road, the Metro Park section. D3 Road, Metro Park section. It will be completed by 2022. It will link up Sheng Feng Road at Cruise Terminal to Sheng Kai Road. And then come 2022, traffic from the Cruise Terminal can go to Chokwa Wan via Sengkai Road, and the other side is Shampo Kong. So by then there will be two exits, and as a result, the traffic will not be stuck at Kowloon Bay. Well, tomorrow, I have put together a meeting for the development panel and the operator of the cruise terminal on how to help serve arriving passengers. So it's 4:30, and Mr. So, if you're interested, you can approach me after the meeting. What about the bikes, the greenway? Thank you for your concern about the greenway. Now, we hope to complete a 13-kilometer greenway in two phases. For leisure riding and also for commuting by members of the public. The width will be 6 to 10 meters wide. In the latter half of 2018, members may recall that we tried it out at Kwun Tong Promenade for 6 months, and response was encouraging. So we are conducting some study. For instance, will there be bikes for rent? And there are sufficient parking spaces here. Can we arrange rental services? We will see whether AI can be used for real-time monitoring. And we can also provide smart routing. Consider providing a divider, because I'm worried about cyclists and pedestrians conflicts. Ms. Alice Mack, am I coming through? Yes. The so-called multimodal EFLS proposal by the administration, as pointed out by a number of members, it took many years for the government to study the system, and now the monorail option has been ruled out. I believe the local community can never be happy with this proposal. I think I've heard comments that the only thing missing from the multimodal EFLS is rickshaws. So at first we were told that there would be an excellent elevated monorail so as not to eat into road surface. So we were given a very rosy picture, but now it has come to nothing. And then so-called new roads in this new area. So there is actually nothing in the proposal. You are just putting together what you have now and give it a name. The current East team of FTU is not going to accept this proposal. It's most disappointing. Now, the residents in current East have to suffer traffic jam day in, day out. In future, there will be a sports park in Kai Tak as well as the cruise terminal in Kai Tak. I think they need mass transport system to address the traffic needs. Instead of this Chap Shui proposal, the presentation here may sound good, but this is not what the local community wants, and it's not going to address the traffic congestion here. So the FTU is not going to accept this traffic proposal. Any response from the secretary? Thank you. Ms. Mack, yes, I can understand the disappointment because I've spent a number of years on the study. But then it's not that there is nothing new in the current proposal. Even for the provision of electric buses or GMBs, now we have elevated walkways and also travelators. We have a 1.3-kilometer elevated walkway. It was not originally in our proposal. Now we have to bear in mind the situation of Kwun Tong commercial area. And we have to more effectively take commuters to the Kwun Tong line. Now for the runway, the TNT situation will be greatly improved in the future. Towards northwest, commuters can go to Shou Wong Toi Station or Kai Tak Station. As I said, in a new area, the traffic infrastructure is sufficient, and existing traffic services will very conveniently take people to the two stations. Now the Chun Ma line is only operating limitedly, but I think in future when it is fully commissioned, it will work. All right, this multimodal EFLS is going to replace the monorail we asked for. Is it all because of money? Is it because the construction cost is too high and that the government doesn't want to do it? Have you considered the aspirations and expectations of the people there? Thank you. Yes, we have a number of factors. Construction cost is just one factor. In 2012, the construction cost was just around $12 billion. Now it will be over $20 billion. And the operating cost, annual operating cost will be about $600 million, and income will be $470 million. So the annual deficit will be to the tune of $130 million, but that is just one factor. Now we have discussed with traffic and transport experts in coming up with the current proposal. We have achieved a 60% cut in traveling time. While we cannot achieve 100% cut, but it is over 60% reduction. So cost is one consideration, but not the sole consideration. Now time is also one consideration. Now, if we use the old proposal, even it is feasible, it will only be commissioned after 2030. But for the landscaped deck in Kuntong, it will be commissioned in a few years' time. And the 1.37 kilometer walkway can be completed in 2027. Now, if everything goes smoothly, the other infrastructure can also be commissioned in 2028. Mr. Wilson Oh, no, we can't hear you yet, Mr. Oh. Please wait. Am I coming through? Yes, you are. Chair. The EFLS in Kowloon East started a discussion in 2010, and then different parties of the legislature spent many years following up. And then our consensus was to adopt an elevated approach. Unfortunately, in this year's policy address, the proposal was aborted. Back then, Carrie Lam was the Secretary for Development, and now she is the CE. The same Carrie Lam has put a full stop to this proposal. Then as member of Kowloon East, I am disappointed and angry. The Secretary said that the current multimodal approach can satisfy the traffic demand. In fact, Kowloon East traffic is heavily congested now. There is the Kai Tak Development Area, Cruise Terminal, Sports Park, and Cha Kun Leng and Downtown New Developments, and also the redevelopment of Kun Tong. I don't think the EFLS you propose here can address the traffic congestion. What you do, you only add to the congestion. And your advisor said that in Kowloon East, we have already got a diversity of efficient and highly connected public transport services. I think he was lying. And you know, public are very unhappy. Let me show you this picture. This was the picture you used to consult us many years ago. It painted a rosy picture for us, but now it has gone down the drains. So is it that the government can only deliver empty talks and is totally incompetent? Now, you spent close to $90 million for consultation and study over 13 years. I'd like to know whether public officers would be held accountable. Could it be possible that the proposal here will be reported in the future and then residents of Kowloon East will be cheated the second time? What is the time frame for delivery here? And then how are you going to address the congestion of the Kun Tong MTR line? The road service is overburdened, and so is the railway system. Can you provide elevators, hillside escalators, so that members of the public can walk, and so that very healthily and efficiently they can get to the railway station?
We thank Mr. Oh for his question. We understand his discontent and anger because it did take a long time. When we have to undertake a detailed feasibility study, and we come across huge challenges and huge costs and a long time, then we have to face that. Now, we have the multimodal approach. Now, we are confident that it can be done. We have detailed timetables. I will ask the CEDD to tell us briefly about the footbridge and the decks and so on the timelines involved. Now, in the PowerPoint just now, we already mentioned these. Now, for the greenway, there will be two stages. Stage 1, about 7.5 kilometers. We believe that by 2023, this part should be completed. For the remaining 5.5 kilometers, this will be done alongside the other developments. After 2025, they will be completed as well. Now, for the landscape deck of the MTL, it will connect with the Kuntong Combined Development Area and Kuntong, and it will link to exits A and C of Kuntong Station. We expect by 2022 we can start the work, and the completion can be in 2025. As for Shengyi Road pedestrian footbridge, we hope that by 2023 we can start the construction. By 2027 it can be completed. As for the Waiyip Street travelator system, 1.3 kilometers, we hope to have some rooftop gardens along the way. We hope that by 2024 we can start the works. By 2027 it can be completed. As for the Kuntong Typhoon Shelter, the pedestrian and cycle bridge, there will be 600 meters across the typhoon shelter, and that will take about 3 years for the design handle the provincial harbor ordinance. We hope that construction can start by 2025. We hope that by 2028 it can be completed. So that's the cursory timetable. Now, on the hillside escalators, now in Kowloon East, there are similar projects. Now, if Mr. Orr has similar proposals, we will be glad to consider those. I said previously, they took 13 years. It's been wasted. And now they will take over 10 years for completion, so it takes over 20 years. So Kowloon East and Kai Tak residents will be very unhappy. Now, your language is beautiful, but they are puzzled. Now, it's almost $19 million. It spent over 13 years. Any administration official have to be held responsible, accountable. In the early days, I came to LegCo. Members asked me, if we embark on a project, will it always succeed? I said no. If difficulties are uncovered, and if there are huge costs in terms of money and time, then we will have to rethink. Now, we have come across these difficulties that are difficult to overcome at Hoyun Road. Now, it's 18 meters between buildings. If we build a elevated mode transport system, it has to be 9 meters wide, and the fire services department wishes that it can be 6 meters wide on a space on either side. So that totally adds up to 21 meters. That's wider than what Hoyun Road can offer. So we try to see whether the fire service can reduce, can you use a space that's less than 6 meters. We also try to see whether the elevated monorail can be less space consuming, and the answers are all negative. So we have to accept the old outcome, and we did try hard to find other ways to provide other alternatives to meet the transport and other needs in the area. That is why in the 2020 policy address, we raised the multimodal approach. Now, there was a lot of consultation, it came to nothing, and it takes 10 years to build all these items. So This is a shame. The government really owes a proper explanation to the Kowloon East residents. For the Kai Tak property owners, when they bought the property, they all looked forward to the monorail. Now, the secretary mentioned all these technical difficulties. They should have told us before today. Now, Hoi Yun Road, the bypass, the heights, and so on, they should have told us earlier on. The Development Bureau should conduct a system review to see whether your feasibility studies could have been done more effectively rather than wasting the taxpayers' money. So I hope the secretary and his team can put these issues on record. If there are no further questions from members, Mrs. Regina Yip, would she be able to come back to speak? Because it seemed that she had some technical difficulty. Mrs. Yip, I'm here. Okay, we can hear you now. Please speak. Okay, the technical problem has been resolved. I'm not a member elected from the Kowloon East. Now, I'm not familiar with Kowloon East, even though I lived in the area for 70 or 18 years. Now, very often friends ask me about the EFLS. Now, some officials already explained to me that they wouldn't embark on it even before I saw the document. It's common sense. The linkage system, it takes a lot of space. It needs support from the ground. And then, unlike the MTRCL, and under the MTR, it cannot be expanded. You have to stay away from buildings, people's homes, and from elevated roads. So officials earlier had told me that it wouldn't be done. Now, this is common sense. So I don't explain why the government doesn't has taken so long and spent so much to engage the consultants. Now, I don't know whether it's costing over $10 million. Now, we're supposed to be environmentally friendly. Now, let's look at the monorail in Disneyland or in Seattle. You know that the monorail cannot be expanded and it takes a lot of space. You said the government is spending the public's money, so it doesn't care, and it did two studies and just come to conclusions that common sense would tell us these are things that couldn't be done. Now, as for the water taxi, now I've been interested now in Island South. For the Ocean Park, they have been talking about water taxi to Taishu Wan. Now, water taxis are attractive, but are they sustainable? Would they be another eventual place where the government has to provide subsidies? Now, for the $2 public transport concession, now the government ends up subsidizing the operators, the water taxis. Can they be self-financing? Why is it that it took so long for the monorail to be concluded as unsuccessful? Now, many conclusions are not immediately apparent. For instance, Hoi Yun Road, the elevated monorail. We need 21 meters in width of space, but we have only 18 meters. Now, can we come up with 3 meters by reducing the space for fire service or for the monorail, but that couldn't be. As for the water taxis, the transport department, please. Now, for the water taxis, one company had won the bid, but due to the pandemic, the implementation wouldn't start till first half of this year. So it's self-financing, it has a tourism element, so that's the approach we're adopting. The water taxi service, in future, will it be, as Ye Chi Ming said, will it help to carry cruise terminal passengers to go to urban areas? Because they wouldn't want to be stuck in Kuntang. Let me supplement. Now, the water taxis, there are five stops: Kai Tak, Hong Ham, Tsim Sha Tsui, Waterfront Promenade, Pier 9 Central, and West Kowloon Cultural District. The operator will provide 3 to 4 services per day, 7:30 at night for viewing the harbour at night. So we will cooperate with the operator, we will monitor the demand, and we may increase the service. Now, there's a stop at Kai Tak to facilitate passengers. So the cruise terminal passengers can take the water taxi to Hong Kong Island, or what? Is it that convenient? Can Mr. Wong respond? Now, for water taxis, the embarking point at Kai Tak is at the steps at the Kai Tak runway, so that's only 5 to 7 minutes walk from the cruise terminal. So we will try to serve the cruise terminal passengers. Now, if you have been on a cruise, now many people want to leave the terminal, and like at the ocean terminal, they try to provide people mover system for people to take the luggage on board, unless they stay in the area for a couple of nights. I think this item has to end at this point. The secretary, I've listened to the members as they speak. They all express a lot of disappointment about the failure of the monorail project. Now, you basically tell the people to use the existing system of transport under the multimodal system. The multimodal system doesn't replace the linkage system of monorail with 9 kilometers and 12 stations, and it connected to Kuntang Station, Kowloon Bay Station, and Kai Tak Station. Now, the secretary mentioned the technical difficulties. I share the same view as the members. If there have been such fundamental difficulties, if the road width is not enough, they shouldn't have told the residents that they will go ahead with the feasibilities. They should have dropped the project, or there should be an alternative proposal or alternative alignments or shortening of the alignment.
I believe our views from members have been heard by the secretary and also his colleagues present. As chairman of the development panel, I can just resign to the fact that the government claims that it cannot do it. For residents of Kowloon East, living in Kai Tak in particular, originally thought that such a system would enable them to be connected to existing railway lines, and which is a very important point for them. Since the project cannot be done now, we can only look to the benefits of the multimodal EFLS. But my feeling is that it can never replace the originally proposal, and we can't help expressing our disappointment. Any final response from the Secretary? Chairman, thank you for your understanding for our practical difficulties. As I've said a number of times, we do appreciate the disappointment expressed by members and you, Chairman. I hope this will be the second best, because, as I said, the commuting time can be cut by about 60% under the multimodal approach, and for different projects, including the walkway and also travelators who have to come to the council for funding approval. I hope we can have your blessing so that residents don't have to wait much longer. Now, moving forward with the support of the council, we can commission these facilities sooner so that residents don't have to continue to wait. Well, in fact, we have overrun a little bit. I have no AOB items. If members have no AOB as well, then the meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much. And thank you, government officials, for your attendance. Thank you.